I will reconvene this regular meeting of the Waco ISD Board of Trustees. We've been in closed session under Texas Government Code Section 551.074, and no action was taken. On behalf of the school board, welcome. Thank you all for coming out tonight. I say it every month, but we really do appreciate your support of the Waco Public Schools and your interest in what's going on our campuses. Everything we do tonight has been posted in accordance with the requirements of the Texas Open Meetings Act. If you have a cell phone or other electronic device with you, if you would take a moment and either put it on silent or turn it off, we would greatly appreciate it. And at this time, I would remind you that the board's purpose is to set goals, listen to reports of the superintendent, approve budgets, contracts, and personnel appointments, as well as make policy for the district. We are not here to make management decisions or to solve problems of individuals, as management is the sole responsibility of the superintendent and her staff. Once again, welcome. Glad you're here. Also, welcome to anybody who's watching at home tonight on Channel 17. And at this time, we'd ask that you join us as we pause for a moment of silence for prayer, contemplation, reflection, or meditation. Thank you. We'll now move on to item 6, Pledge of Allegiance. Dr. Kane.
Thank you, Mr. President. Tonight we're pleased to have two students from South Waco Elementary to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. Please welcome fifth graders from Mr. Roberts' class, Jezebel Ciniceros and Marquesia Uregas Long.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Thank you, students. Board members, please join me in front of the dais for tonight's special presentations. To begin the special recognition portion of our meeting, we want to express appreciation to tonight's Pledge of Allegiance leaders from South Waco Elementary. Their teacher, Mr. Joseph Roberts, describes both students as very nice, hardworking, and extremely polite, that they are model students. Jezebel Ciniceros is a fifth grade student whose favorite subjects are math and science. When not at school, she loves to play outside. And when she isn't outside, she enjoys watching Netflix. When she grows up, she wants to become a marine biologist. We know that Jezebel's parents, Anna Estrada, who is here tonight, and Ubaldo Ciniceros, who could not join us tonight, are very proud of her. Mom, would you like to stand up as your daughter is Miss Ciniceros?
Over here.
Ah. Yay! Marquesia Uregas Long, also a fifth grade student, says that her favorite subject in school is science. That's great news because when she grows up, Marquesia wants to become a nurse. Her activities include softball and cheerleading, and she also loves reading and listening to music. We want to recognize Marquesia's mother, Daisy Uregas, who is here tonight. If she can stand up. Okay, great. And her father, Marcus Long, who could not be with us tonight. We also want to say thank you to our adoptive school partner, Barnes & Noble Booksellers, for donating the books our pledge leaders are receiving. The Academic Decathlon is an annual high school competition that began in Orange County, California in 1968 and later expanded nationwide to become the United States Academic Decathlon Association in 1982. This scholastic event is designed to include students from all achievement levels. Teams are placed in one of three divisions based on their cumulative grade point average: honors, scholastic, and varsity. In January, the Waco High School Academic Decathlon team competed against students from 15 other schools at the Regional Academic decathlon tournament held in Arlington at Lamar High School. Medals were awarded for individual events and by division. Each event requires knowledge in many disciplines, including literature, math, music, economics, science, art, social studies, speech, interview, and also the team super quiz event. Overall, the Waco High team placed 6th out of the 16 schools at the tournament and within the top half of all medium-sized schools within the state. In addition, team members Christian Allen earned a record high number of points for a single student at Waco High. Welcome, Waco High School Academic Decathlon Regional Champions. Maria Acevedo, Varsity Division Bronze Medalist in Social Studies and highest individual score in the Varsity Division. Christian Ibarra, Varsity Division Bronze Medalist in two events, Interview and Art. Christian Allen, highest individual score in the Honors Division setting and in the Honors Division, setting a school record with the number of points scored by a single student. Julian Nicholson, Honors Division team member. Grace Dennis, Varsity Division team member. Tyrese Beasley, Scholastic Division team member. I'm sorry, thank you. Mark Jackson, junior coach. Stephanie Flores, junior coach. And Waco High's academic decathlon team is coached by Wendy Moles.
Thank you so much. And the board will want to go talk.
One of the reasons that University High and Waco High Schools have such strong musical theater programs is due to the high caliber fine arts education that students receive in our elementary and middle school programs. Earlier this spring, Waco ISD middle school students auditioned for places in the Texas Music Educators Association Region 8 All-Region Choir. This All-Region Choir is comprised of the very best middle school vocalists in the region, which include school districts as far away as Killeen, College Station, and Gatesville. Over 1,100 middle school students auditioned for fewer than 200 coveted places in the regional choir. I am very proud to report that all 5 Waco ISD middle schools were represented in the audition process, and all 5 Waco ISD middle schools are represented in the TMEA Region 8 All-Region Middle School Choirs. From Cesar Chavez Middle School, Christian Davalos is not here, but his teacher is. Christian made All-Region Boys Choir Tenor 2. He made history as the first ever qualifier from Cesar Chavez Middle School. Melanie Silva is our choir director at Cesar Chavez. Okay, good. Come on, right over here. From Indian Spring Middle School, Mahalia Mann Davis, 7th grade, All-Region Choir, Soprano 2. Paige Mitchell, Indian Spring Middle School, Choir Director. From Tennyson Middle School, Brianna Takarat, 8th grade, All-Region Choir, Soprano 1. Isabel Weaver, 7th grade, All-Region Choir, Alto. Neil Dupuy, 7th grade, All-Region Choir, Tenor 1. And our choir director from Tennyson Middle School, Joy Marshall. Congratulations, students, on your hard work, and thank you to our middle school choir directors for your hard work in preparing these talented students for their auditions. Also, I would like to recognize Mr. Larry Carpenter, Waco ISD Director of Fine Arts, for his leadership and support of our students and teachers. Hey, how are you doing? You must be... The Waco High School's varsity basketball team finished the season as the District 17 5A champions and Region 3 quarterfinalists. They are Jerrica Brooks, second team All-District, Academic All-District. T Erica Carr, second team All-District. Ty Kayla DeGreat, academic All-District. Kamaya Hamilton, academic All-District. Shay Hudlin, first team All-District, first team Super Syntex, Texas Association of Basketball Coaches All-Region, and Texas Girls Coaches Association All-State. Olivia Jackson, academic All-District. Jonesha Mosley, first team All-District. Jasmine Wilson, honorable mention All-District. Don't go. Freshman coach Arnisha Linville, assistant coach Kay Moore. And our head coach was Coach Ross Barber, but he was not able to be here tonight. The Waco High boys basketball team ended the season with 21 wins, 12 losses, and another trip to the playoffs. In the past 3 years, they are the only team in Central Texas winning 20 or more games in a season. They have gone to the playoffs 5 consecutive years. This year's senior class has 64 wins and 31 losses over their varsity career. Tonight, we're pleased to recognize the Waco High Lions Class 5A basketball team. DJ Montgomery, second team All-District, academic All-District. Dale Smith, newcomer of the year. Will Richards, honorable mention, All-District, academic All-District. And we have assistant coach Robert Garcia and head coach John Weeks. And now, board members, we're going to take a few seconds to brag about a couple of your own members. We know that each of you spends countless hours as public servants working together as a school board for the common good of our community and our children. But what our citizens may not know is that each of you also go above and beyond the call of duty. In addition to a board member's regular duties and legally required continuing education, our board members often choose to serve on local, regional, and statewide committees and boards representing our district and our community in a variety of meaningful ways. I will give you just two examples tonight. Waco ISD trustee for District 3, Mr. Larry Perez, was recently elected to serve a 3-year term on the 15-member Mexican American School Board Association Board of Directors. The MASBA board is comprised of 6 regions that represent the 20 Texas Education Agency TEA school district regions. As Texas school districts experience unprecedented growth and in many cases may lack the understanding and resources to ensure the most appropriate and effective curriculum implementation as it relates to Hispanic students, the goal of MASBA is to unite school board members and districts to find solutions, to discuss legislation and examine current affairs as they relate to education. We're very proud that Waco ISD trustee Larry Perez is one of only 15 school board members from districts across the state of Texas elected to serve on this statewide board. He not only represents Waco ISD, which has a Hispanic Latino student population of 59%, and he represents Region 12, which has a Hispanic population of 52%, but he also represents Regions 10 and 11. Congratulations on your new position, Mr. Perez. We look forward to great things, and we have a very unique gift. This is one of the first Waco ISD umbrellas with Waco ISD on it.
Ha ha ha!
Notice I said there were two board members that we wanted to speak of. We have another board member who was recently honored for his leadership, servant heart, and willing spirit and deep commitment as a longtime member, officer, and committee chairman of the Waco NAACP. Trustee Norman Manning, who represents District 1 and also serves as secretary to the Waco ISD School Board, was recently named the 2016 Waco NAACP Outstanding Member of the Year. It was for his support of the mission of the NAACP through his commitment and service. Mr. Manning has been praised for his efforts to revitalize the organization and credited for his efforts to recruit individuals to join and to take leadership roles. He currently serves as the chapter sergeant-at-arms and parliamentarian. He has served as chair of the Legal Redress and Criminal Justice Committees and is known for helping in many other unsung ways. Mr. Manning is described by the chapter's president as dependable. The chapter's president often places him at the top of her volunteer sign-up list without his knowledge because she knows he will always be early, always be prepared, and always ready to work, and he will always stay late after meetings to ensure everyone's safety. His commitment to the Waco NAACP is all the more remarkable in light of his dedication to the many other organizations throughout the Waco community that includes Waco ISD. So you've got to start down here with Mr.
All right, congratulations to everyone who was recognized tonight. I do want to say something about those last two. In all sincerity, first of all, when Ms. Pettis emailed Dr. Kane and I and told us that he had been selected, I asked him if this was his first time, and he had actually was asked to serve one time prior. So this is his second term as board of directors of MASBA. And I really want to thank the administration for giving him the recognition this time, for all the extra time it takes to do that, to putting it on our website, recognizing him tonight, because that's really going above and beyond. Larry, thank you for doing that.
Well, thank you.
I think he kept it secret last time. Yeah. I could start following you guys now.
And we always see each other in the context of these board meetings. And I was actually at the NAACP banquet the night they recognized Norman as the member of the year. And what was fascinating is in the introduction, they never referenced his service on the Waco School Board. They talked about other things he did in the community where he was working to really empower folks across the board, things he was doing to work hard for that organization and for folks in this community who need additional help and representation. And then hearing your remarks and just the sincere humility with which you addressed that group that night was very moving, and it was very well deserved, and congratulations. We will move on to, tell you what, we're going to take a couple of things out of order unless there's some objection. First of all, Dr. Kane has asked that we move down to item 10C, consider hiring of administrators. Is there any objection to taking that out of order? All right, then we'll go ahead and move on to hiring of administrators. Dr. Kane.
Well, actually, Mr. President, the first one is not a hire. The first one's a reassignment. So this is an announcement. We're very proud. In fact, it's been difficult to keep it not secret, but us not talking about it, so it could be an announcement tonight. But we're very pleased to announce that Ms. Daphne Latchinson has been assigned from assistant principal at Waco High to principal of Brazos High School. Ms. Latchinson has been in education for 12 and a half years. She has most recently served as assistant principal at Waco High for the past 4 years before accepting this position as principal of the Brazos High Credit Recovery. Before moving to administration, she taught fourth and fifth grades in Killeen ISD and was a third grade teacher and reading interventionist for Waco ISD. She got her Bachelor of Science in Elementary Education from Baylor, and she got her Master of Education in Teacher Leadership from Lamar University. She is certified principal, elementary self-contained, elementary reading. In her leisure time, she enjoys flying with her kids, her mother, and her siblings to her baby brother's NFL games in Kansas City. She also enjoys supporting her three beautiful children in all their sporting events after school, and her dream vacation is to travel to Africa and give back to village children. Congratulations.
Daphne, I know you don't have a microphone, but I also see you've brought some family tonight. And because I'm an honorary member of the Johnson family, I want you to introduce our family members who are here tonight. Thank you, ma'am.
And, Mr. President, for the position I am recommending that the board take action on, I'm recommending Ms. Jessica Torres be the assistant principal at Brook Avenue. Ms. Torres has been in education for 12 years. She served as an instructional coach at Lake Air Montessori before accepting the position, before being recommended the position of assistant principal at Brook Avenue Elementary. Before moving into administration, she taught 3 years at South Waco Elementary and lower elementary grades at Lake Air Montessori. She has her Bachelor of Science in Interdisciplinary Studies from Stephen F. Austin, a Master of Education degree in Educational Administration from Concordia University, and a Doctor of Education Leadership. She's currently pursuing that at Tarleton. In her leisure time, she enjoys spending time with her family, especially with her two children, Brett and Hunter. She and husband Loopy enjoy cooking together and going on hikes in Cameron Park. An avid reader and technology enthusiast, Ms. Torres strives to continue her learning for the benefit of our students. And I'm recommending that the board name her assistant principal at Brook Avenue.
Very good. I always make people nervous with this, but we haven't approved that one yet, so y'all may be applauding too early. All right, I will entertain a motion to accept the administration's recommendation.
So moved.
Thank you, Ms. Pettit. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Dupuy. Any questions, comments, discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Jessica, welcome. You have family here this evening as well? And I got to meet your mother last weekend at Lake Air Montessori, and she convinced my wife to buy goods from her booth. So thank you for accepting the assignment, and congratulations. Unless anybody objects, we're also going to take the employee opinion survey out of order because we have an out-of-town presenter. Hearing none, we will skip down to item 11A, 2016 Annual Employee Opinion Survey. Ms. Bauman, Dr. Kane.
Yes, this is our fifth year.
Yes, ma'am.
And for most of the questions, we have the same questions. Every once in a while, a new question comes up, and 1 year I think we skipped a question. Just inadvertently, but it really becomes more meaningful every year when you see the patterns. And so this has really been a good process for us. We go over the results. We actually also have campus results with principals We go over it with teachers sometimes, so if we have concerns on the campus, there seems to be a pattern, we ask the teachers. So, Ms. Bowman, if you would, make your fifth presentation for us.
Thank you.
I noticed you've changed your style. This is the first time we've used this format, so.
I like pictures.
It's like going to the Star Wars.
I'm very visual, so we're going to do pictures tonight. Just some background information about how the survey was put together. TASB HR Services collected all the data on the survey. We processed the data and presented the report. The district didn't have any access whatsoever to any of the raw data. So that information that you receive in the report that you have is everything that the district has received. The data was collected online primarily, but we did provide paper surveys to employees of the district who did not have readily have access to computers here at work. We did also, because of that, you have a higher participation rate among your auxiliary staff that don't work with computers every day. All 2,437 WISD employees were invited to respond to the survey, and you received a 60% response rate on the survey. It's a little bit lower than it has been in previous years, but you still had.
Did we read anything into that? I mean, does that mean people are happy? Does it mean they?
I don't know what it means, to tell you the truth. I don't know. But I will tell you that you're not the only district that had a lower participation rate this year.
Okay.
Some things caught us after the surveys were done. There was just a lot going on this time of year, and it could be that the employees were distracted by other things. In fact, today we even got calls from surveys that closed 2-3 weeks ago saying, can I still take that survey? We're past that point, but you weren't the only district that had a lower participation rate this year.
But if you want to say that means they're happy,
what was ours like? Can you remember what it was last year?
Last year it was 68%,
okay,
and
so
the year before 64%. So it's not really terribly out of line with what you've had in the past. And you still have a very strong survey. The confidence interval was 1.6%. Which basically we can say that we're 95% confident that the data that you're looking at tonight is accurate, give or take 1.6%. That's pretty darn strong. This kind of breaks down visually the participation based on job type. As you can see, the 43% up there, those are the teachers. Because of the fact that you have because so many of the respondents are teachers, of course, their opinions are going to hold stronger weight, the stronger influence with the results of the survey. We also broke down the participation by length of employment just so that you can get a look at it. If you can see that your participation by length of employment is pretty steady. It's pretty well spread out. But one thing I do want to point out that this group, which represents 47% of the people who participated in the survey, have 3 years or less experience with the district. That doesn't mean that they're teachers or employees with less than three years or less in education. It just means they've been employed by the district for that period of time. If we were able to personify the survey taker, we would say it would be an elementary school teacher with 3 years or less at Waco ISD. 45% of the people who responded to the survey worked at an elementary school, so that's where that idea comes from. One of the things we also asked the employees was if they would identify some factors that they feel are the most important to them in terms of their job satisfaction. Number one on the list was meaningful work. Number two was compensation and benefits. And number three was respectful treatment of all employees. And respectful treatment of all employees, that is a new one that we added to the list for this year. And we're seeing it being rated very high across the state with all the surveys that we've been doing. So let's break it down based on what they said was important to them. Here's some of the statements that relate to that topic. The work I do is meaningful. You can see it's been pretty steadily the same throughout the last five years. My job challenges me, the same type of thing, very steady in terms of response, also very high high levels of agreement. What you're looking at the bars here is that this represents all of the people who said that they either agree or strongly agreed with this particular statement, my job challenges me. On most days, I feel good about what I've accomplished. Again, over 90%, very high levels of agreement. Compensation and benefits was one of the key areas. This is one that I want to take a close look at. My pay is fair for the work I do. It is up 6% from last year, and it also has a positive 12% trend since 2013. My pay is competitive is another statement they responded to. That's up 7% this year, and since 2012, it has a 15% positive trend. They also responded to the leave time provided to me is appropriate. That's up 17% since 2013. There is really very little change between last year and this year. Really nothing notable at all, but the 14% over that four-year period of time, I think, is notable. And then respectful treatment. Coworkers are supportive. The principal treats me with respect. You can see it's been fairly steady and high. The staff is courteous and respectful. The HR staff is courteous and respectful. These are just statements that I pulled out of the entire survey that referred to respect. We looked at just an average for a relationship with supervisor. There really wasn't much of a change at all, nothing that's really notable from last year to this year. So that you can see 80%+ average rating on relationship with supervisor. Relationship with coworkers was also very positive. There was no notable change. So let's take a look at the rest of the story here. Job satisfaction engagement as a whole. Employees asked to respond to a statement, I'm proud to work for Waco ISD. 88% agreed with that statement. As I said, there's little change from 2015, but it went up 9% since 2014. So there was some notable change over time. Employees that would recommend the district, 76% said that they would, which is up 6% in this year and goes up 14% from 2014. So there's a very positive trend there. They're recommending this as a place of employment to their friends. They're asked, would you recommend the district? And then a separate question, would you recommend your campus or department as a good place to work?
Here, please, Mike, toward you. Oh, okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, Norman.
77% would recommend their campus or department. There is very little change this year, but it is up 7% since 2015. Working conditions is another key area for employee engagement and satisfaction. 85% said that the hours they work are reasonable. There's really no remarkable change from last year. 76% said their workload is appropriate. It went up a little bit this year, but really not enough to be notable. However, it is up 7% since 2013, so it's moving in a positive direction, though not in notable leaps and bounds. District communication averaged 86%. There was less than a 2% change overall. There was one statement I wanted to point out, though, that kind of was a standout. I'm satisfied with employee communications. The response level is at 83%, is 6% higher than it was last year, and shows an 11% positive trend over the last 3 years. Now, under district leadership, one of the things I want to point out about this one in particular, I feel supported and appreciated by the Board of Trustees. This question is a little bit unusual in the fact that there's a higher number of individuals who responded that they had no opinion on this particular question than we typically see. So that's one of the reasons that the overall percentages appear to be a little bit lower, because more people have no opinion than is usual. I do want to point out that it's up 6% from last year and has a 14% positive trend since 2013. Campus environment, the average rating was 82%. Again, there's no real change from previous years. There's a series of questions about resources and teacher development. Only teachers responded to this particular series of questions. One of the things I want to say is overall the responses remain steady in terms of the level of agreement. Just to give you an idea of some of the highlights, access to instructional resources, 76% agreed that they had access to instructional resources, which is up 6%, and that's really the only notable change in that area. Resources for special populations, they are less satisfied with this, but there really isn't a change. It's held steady this year, but it's gone up 8% over the last 2 years. So there has been some progress on that. 66% of the people agreed that they have a role, the teachers agree that they have a role in selecting instructional resources, very similar to the previous year. 70% said that were satisfied with the instructional program, believed that it was effective. It is pretty level with last year. I think there was a 1% change, so it's nothing, there was really no change. Staff development remained level as well, with 65% indicating satisfaction with staff development. Instructional support team ratings, I averaged those, 74% on average. There was absolutely no change on those two statements. They were absolutely identical to 2015. Student discipline is another area that only teachers responded to. This statement, the principal's leadership, about the principal's leadership in setting behavioral standards, it, as you can see, it is absolutely identical to the 2015 ratings. Consistent enforcement of student code of conduct, consistent with last year's ratings, and assistance with disciplinary problems in the classroom remained level as well. 12% of the people who responded to the survey added additional comments. 35% of those comments were accolades. People commented on their enjoyment of working for the district. They also gave compliments to other employees, including principals, assistant principals, and coworkers. The largest number of complaints were regarding the supervisor's management style, and covered a range of anything from, intimidation tactics, inconsistent communication, contradictory communication, fair treatment of employees, or not addressing inappropriate behaviors of other employees. The next biggest set of comments was on student discipline, and that was followed by curriculum and instruction and workload, with a broad range of topics that are tucked into the other category. You also did a customer service survey, a brief customer service survey, and there really is not a whole lot of new and exciting stuff to talk to you about. It's remained fairly steady. Human resources received an average rating of 92%. Technology average rating of level of agreement and satisfaction of 89%. There was one area that was notable, maintenance and repairs being prompt and effective, was up 6% from the previous year and up 11% from 2012. Any questions?
Thank you, Rhonda. Any questions from the board? Any comments? If you'll pull the mic towards you.
Yeah.
On the survey, is there a space there for ethnicity of who's doing? No. Okay.
No.
Start on that.
No.
Thank you.
Other It'd questions?
It would be interesting to see the ethnicity of each person that's doing the survey, just to show a few things.
Yeah. Okay.
Other questions or comments?
Hi. Thank you so much for the report. I was wondering, how are the questions selected, or could you kind of help me with the survey responses and how are those questions, I guess, selected?
We constantly are looking at appropriate questions that will measure employee satisfaction and engagement. Then we also take a better look at the working conditions, which is a lot to do with satisfaction and engagement, of course. Mm-hmm. We do that by basically studying other surveys, studying the results of those surveys, and what kinds of trends that we're looking for that will measure these particular aspects of employment. We also look very carefully at what is important to teachers in terms of retention and engagement, because that's, you know, obviously a key issue when half of your district population is their teachers. Mm-hmm. And so that's where a lot of the questions come from. We work with Dr. Kane and her staff to identify some things that are very very important about on a local level, as far as those key questions are concerned. So they're kind of integrated together, and we've refined them so that we have a steady set of questions from year to year, and we can compare changes during that period.
Yeah, thank you so much. I have one more question.
Yeah, sure.
Okay. I was looking on the findings, factors that contribute to job satisfaction. And on this, what would you say, according to research, or are the kind of top factors that contribute to job satisfaction and retention of teachers?
From a school district perspective, meaningful work seems to be one of the three on the top of the list. I need to look at the list here to prompt my memory on it. We typically see respectful treatment of all employees. Relationship with coworkers is usually fairly high on the list. Relationship with supervisors is usually higher than it was for your district. And compensation and benefits, it's rarely on the top of the school district list, but it is frequently somewhere around 2 to 4 on the list.
Okay. Great.
Hey, Ms. Cordway. Other questions, comments?
Yes.
Go ahead, Mr. Manning.
Also, under that area of findings, job security, that rated low. Were there any comments, notable comments about that you can remember? I was trying to find them in here, but.
I don't recall a comment at all about job security. And on the list of the factors that contribute to job satisfaction, I would be speculating, but I would think maybe the reason job security is further down at the list is because they're not as concerned about whether or not they're going to have their position next year. That's usually what happens is it's critical in years when budgets are tight and there's concerns about layoff, but once that passes, the job comfort level or confidence level that they're going to have a job improves and it becomes less of an issue. When you look at the working conditions on page 8, the full chart, I feel secure in my employment with the district. 8 out of 10 people said that they felt secure with their employment at the district.
So that's good then.
Yeah, it's excellent.
And it's up from 64% 4 years ago.
Yes.
Other questions, comments? Ron, I say it every year, but I mean, this is, thank you for helping us do this. I mean, for years, we sort of had to rely on anecdotal stories about what employees were experiencing out on the campus. And typically when you rely on anecdotal stories, you get a disproportionate number of reports of negative concerns. And having this actual data is helpful to the board. I know several years ago, we identified three areas that looked like they were significant and much lower than maybe some of the other answers, and the administration focused on them. And I mean, everything you presented tonight is trending upward, and that says a lot about the administration and their efforts. So, and we wouldn't know that without your taking the time to crunch these numbers. So thank you.
Well, you guys are great to work with. I will say that I really enjoy the fact that once we deliver the survey, Dr. Kane has usually got a list of, could you drill down a little further on this? And it's a joy to have to work with a superintendent who really wants to get down to the facts.
What's the longest length of time? Is it 5 years that you show? Because I know there, you probably have some
five
districts
years.
That have 20 years worth
and
of.
I'm looking at this and I'm thinking maybe this is the sixth year, because I think 1 year might have dropped off.
This is the first, I think.
Is that it?
No, we didn't drop off. No, we've
okay,
been.
This one, because we just show 5 years.
But,
I
didn't ask my question well.
Okay.
I meant for all districts, is that, because, you know, showing 10 years is probably too many. So is it 5 years kind of the chunk you use?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes,
so the bottom year drops off each year, and it's, because it may be, sometimes we may ask you to say, let's do 1, 5, 9, 10, 11, 12, you know, because it is kind of nice to. I'll be calling you.
All right. Other questions, comments?
One quick comment.
Yes, Ms. Sykes.
I just want to thank you for your visual representations, because it makes it much easier to see that.
This is
and
great.
And then lift it out of the detail that we've got.
I will share that with the person who designed this.
Whoever designed
it. Well
done. They get a, tell them they get a.
It's very well done.
I will do that.
Yeah.
I will do that. Thank you.
Not only is it informative, it just looks good, and it's just easy to read. It's a wow. Totally.
Well, you don't have to sit down and figure out, well, you know, while somebody's six sentences ahead of you, which way did that line go? So,
that's
helps me too.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mr. President.
Mr. Manning.
We're going to do this again next year, 2017.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
We ought to be off the charts next year.
I think so.
Thank you again. Safe travels.
Thank you.
We will go back up to item 8, audience for guests. I've had one individual sign up, Pam Cooper. From our friends at AFT.
I figure you've been asleep since Saturday, so.
Well, we're still our packing boxes. I just wanted to say thank you to the board, Dr. Kane, Mr. Adkins, and the rest of the board for supporting this endeavor to get the books out. And let me tell you, the books came and went. So we have students all over the district with books. Without your assistance, the warehouse, the people at the warehouse that unloaded with the forklifters and help us unbox those things.
Over here.
We're awesome help. We appreciate it. We appreciated all the PR that went out. So I think we're all over Waco. So it's a good thing. And we're hoping maybe we can do something else to help enrich the lives of our students and the recognition that Waco ISD and the greater Waco AFT enjoy working together. Thank you.
And before you sit down.
Yes. Yeah, you're not going anywhere.
Obviously, Dr. Kane and I were out there Saturday morning, and I want to commend AFT because just the logistics of passing out 40,000 free books and doing it in such a manner that there were no traffic problems, that people were able to get in, students were able to find the books they wanted. Rosalinda was there passing out the T-shirts, and it was just the thought y'all put into sort of how to lay that situation out, and obviously the first edition of the Rick Reardon book that all the middle school and high school students got to have was also a added plus, but you're to be commended, because that was, I didn't know what to expect.
Neither
when
did
we got down there. I know, we were told, I think we both got down there a little before 10, which is when it was supposed to start, and you had family showing up at 8 a.m. ready to pull up and taking books, and so, but you were accommodating, with parents and students and teachers, and it was really just well done. And more importantly, you and your organization giving this community 40,000 books for these young people to read this spring and into the summer is really powerful. So thank you.
Thank you. We appreciate all your help.
Ms. Cooper.
One quick question. I know y'all had 40,000 books, but y'all keep counting how many people came in actually came?
We have it on a list, but we haven't added it on.
Okay. All right.
Yeah. Well, come back and tell us.
We have a list of it, the parents that came in and went out and how many books they took their children. Now, some of the teachers, we gave 40 books to when they started getting
here. Yes.
We gave 25 to. So they all went out, except for the few that reported, which we are giving out to the schools now.
Yeah, I think also the invisible people were the teachers who came Monday night, Tuesday night, Wednesday night, and Thursday night. Because as President Atkins said, it was set up. I was thinking, oh my gosh, have they thought about this, that, and the other? Because that could have been a nightmare. It was seamless.
We had over 184 volunteers. And I didn't mention the Key Club at University High. They were awesome, and we're giving certificates out to them. They came and worked every day.
Okay. Great job,
AFT. Everybody was happy.
Great job.
Correct. All right, we will move on.
And thank you for the police department because they sent an officer as well. So thank you to the chief.
Item 9, consent agenda. I've been asked to pull items P, R, and S. Is there anything else anyone wants pulled? All right, then I will entertain a motion to adopt the consent agenda with the exception of items P, R, and S.
I'll move.
Thank you, Ms. Pettis. Is there a second?
Sorry.
Thank you, Ms. Manning. Any questions or comments? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? The consent agenda is adopted unanimously. It's my understanding from the administration we're going to take no action on items P or R, correct?
That is correct.
All right. That brings us to item S, and there were two individuals. The first one, I think it's unanimous. Well, let's see. I will entertain a motion to adopt or accept the administration's recommendation that good cause did not exist with respect to Mr. Morton.
So,
Mr. Morton is the individual who's in Arizona now.
Let's do, so make it two agenda, okay.
I move that we accept the administration recommendation on Mr. Morton.
All right, thank you, Mr. Manning. Is there a second? Thank you, Mr. Dupuy. Any discussion? All right, and this is the individual who's now pursuing activities in Arizona. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? That carries unanimously, and I will entertain a motion with respect to Mr. Chandler. Again, we accept the administration's recommendation that good cause did not exist.
Trying to find the spot in the agenda. We've been taking too many things out of order.
I'm sorry.
No, that's all right. Got it.
Is there a motion?
I just want to make sure. Well, hang on. I want to make sure we got the right thing. Morton Chandler. Okay, we're taking these individuals separately.
Right.
Okay. Well, I move that we accept the administration's recommendation.
That's Mr. Chandler. All right. Is there a second?
Mr. Chandler.
All right. Moved and seconded. All those in favor, say aye. All those opposed, nay.
Nay.
All right. Motion carries 5-2. All right. Discussion, possible action, item 10A, campus-based family services. Dr. Kane.
Yes, sir. We've had several presentations. It morphed into the proposal you had before you tonight. Dr. John Singletary and his assistant were here last week. We answered questions. I've not had any questions through the week, so I'm recommending that you approve the School of Social Work's portion of our TRE campus-based family services plan. You will also, next board meeting, have a contract from Dr. Tyrone Tanner, who's doing a portion of this, and then soon after that from the school, Baylor School of Education. But tonight, I just want us to focus on and ask that you approve the School of Social Work's proposal.
Thank you, Dr. King. Any questions, comments, further discussion? All right, I will entertain a motion to accept the administration's recommendation.
So moved.
Thank you, Mr. Dupuy. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Manning. Anybody have anything else? All right, then all those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries unanimously. 10B, approved Crestview Provident Heights rezoning. Dr. Kane.
Yes, sir. We had made a proposal earlier in the year, and the board had some concerns. Mr. Hartley went back and worked with Dr. Tapera and the principals on coming up with an alternate plan. We brought that, I think, last week, and we made tweaks to get all the students going to Tennyson, all the middle school students going to Tennyson. Of course, we would do that.
All the Crestview students?
Yes.
And then the Indian Spring, I mean, all the Provident Heights would go to Indian Spring?
Yes. Okay. Yes. So that, because one board, one of the concerns of the board was that some of the students would go to one middle school and a small number would go to another. So we worked through that, and this is the proposal that we're making, and I'm recommending that the board approve option, we're calling it 4T for Tennyson. It was option 4 last week, and we put T for the Tennyson.
Okay. Are there any questions, comments?
Oh, I have a question.
As Ms. far Portaway.
As Ms. Hall, have we talked to the principals, and do we know what their opinion or their thoughts on kind of this rezoning of these students, what they are?
We asked the principals.
Have we asked the principals?
Oh, Mr. Hartley, if you would come down. You just made his day. He's been waiting. He's been preparing, so thank you.
Yes, actually, we've spoken with both the elementary principals and also with Lisa Hall at Tennyson. They're all in favor of this plan.
Okay.
Other questions, comments? And just so I'm clear on what the administration's recommendation is, those students that are on one of these campuses, as long as their parents provide transportation, could be grandfathered.
Absolutely. We don't want to disrupt any current setting. Right. So if their students currently at Indian Spring, we'd like them to continue. And if we've got a case where we've got a child who's attending right now, and they've got a upcoming sixth grade student for next year, that you would also be allowed to stay at Indian Spring with their sibling. We don't want to break up any families.
Thanks, sir. Other questions or comments?
And because of the timing, if the board passes this, we would immediately begin notifying parents and working with a smooth transition.
Mr. Dupuy?
Yeah, I probably should have asked this question last week. I don't have any obvious objection to what we're doing, but I'm just wondering, you know, Tennyson is pretty crowded, as it is.
Yes, there.
I suppose arguably we're only incrementally exacerbating that condition. Currently enrollment, I mean, help me out here. Current enrollment is 865?
Yes.
And then including Atlas, of course. Next year we're anticipating 936?
Yes, we are.
But then the rezoning would add 6 to that, which adding 6 kids is no big deal.
The next year's 12.
953, immediate change.
I want to provide you two different numbers.
Explain line 2 of that chart for me.
Well, I provided two different numbers for you. The 942 number meant if we phased in just the incoming sixth graders, so adding 6 students only. The 953 is if we moved all students, 6th, 7th, and 8th next year from that area over to Tennyson. That would actually be moving them out of Indian Spring into Tennyson.
And we'll decide on which one we're going to do?
The recommendation is for the phase-in, which would be the 942 number.
Okay. I'm sorry. Gotcha. Okay. And I guess the finally getting to my question. What problems is it going to cause, and how are we going to address them? I mean, what do we anticipate happening? What thought have we given this?
Even before we considered moving those students over with a phase-in plan, we were already identifying the fact that we were going to have a large enrollment next year.
Right.
We were already in plans for bringing in additional barracks, making additional classroom space at Tennyson.
Okay. And we've got room in the cafeteria. And
we do.
We won't be starting
lunch. We're getting close, but we do.
Okay. Okay, all right. Thank you.
Thanks, Mr. Tweed. Mr. Pettis.
How many students does Tennyson actually fit into Tennyson? How many can accept?
I think our capacity was just over 1,000, but that was working at a 28-to-1 classroom ratio. We don't really want that. No. That's the maximum class size we're looking at. Since we're staffing at a much lower ratio, we can still hold it, but we're growing. We're going to get closer.
So Crestview's overcrowded?
Yes, it is.
And Provident Heights is under.
That principal would like additional students.
Needs absolutely. Additional students.
Well, can't we put some Crestview into Provident Heights?
Actually, we're doing just that's that. We're moving 74 okay. students.
Oh, and then we started talking about the middle school. Sorry, we seem to be focusing more on the middle school. But yes, sir, that's
okay. All right, thank you.
Other questions, comments?
Sorry, Rick. Oh, sorry.
Just Ms. how Fox? Many portables do we have at Tennyson now?
I think there's probably 11 at the moment. That's an estimate off the top of my head, but I think it's fairly close. And we've been there. We've got room to bring in more. A little bit more.
So with Provident Heights, will there be enough rooms, or what would this number of students entail? Would it entail a portable there, or?
No. That campus right now has around 345 students, but they can hold 480. So okay. They are very much under-enrolled at the moment. So mm-hmm. These students will actually help that campus.
Okay. So there's enough rooms for them. We wouldn't need to.
Yes, this only puts them at 87% capacity.
I need to say something. Yeah, on that chart that is shown right now, that chart was not, when we do enrollment projections, this was not meant for this purpose, and the out years have not been adjusted for that increase in Atlas. So those numbers are probably low. This was strictly for FTE, for staffing for 2016-17, so don't rely on those out years.
We're not going to lose 65 kids next year.
We will call you in 2020 and ask you why.
Yeah, because I just made the Atlas changes, I just did it for the 2016-17 year. I did not adjust the out years, so that is not correct.
Okay.
One more quick.
Yeah, Ms. Sykes.
I think that's a point. With the growth in Atlas, is that going to, assuming that the numbers increase every year, how is that going to look at Tennyson then from a capacity standpoint?
I mean, we will look at what we have on site. We, as I said, we have plans to bring in more barracks. We are actually even working a different plan of converting some of the current physical building and creating two more classrooms using what we even have right now. So we are projecting not just immediate, but a couple years down the line as well.
Okay.
What's the max for Atlas per grade?
We don't have a max for Atlas. If they qualify for GT, they have the opportunity to come to Atlas. Go.
Now there is a way to control that number, because you can typically 3-5% of your true gifted kids. Mm-hmm. And so you can be you can go up to whatever level. To be more inclusive, you could get up to 10, 11, 12, 13%. So that's something that, now you don't ever go back and unidentify somebody, but over time you can control that number. We are above the 3-5%.
Other questions, comments? I think Dr. Kane said it probably best last week, that there are no really good options trying to address an overcrowded situation at Crestview and an undercrowded situation at Provident Heights, and trying to not put four, five, six kids in a situation where they go to school with their friends in elementary and then go somewhere else. And to the extent we're looking, I guess, at about four blocks, this is probably about as minimally disruptive as you. I mean, I'm one of the ones who hates doing any sort of rezoning, because I think families get mm-hmm. accustomed to, but I am sensitive to the overcrowding at Crestview. And this is administration's recommendation tonight. This is the best way to go.
And I think some of those kids are going to really thrive at Provident Heights because of the overcrowding at Crestview. a lot of times initially it's annoying to the family, but then they start looking at the benefits, and there are a lot of benefits for our students to have smaller campuses and to be in less crowded circumstances. So yes, sir, I'm recommending that the board approve 4T, the plan 4T.
Okay.
I think at the elementary level, it's a no-brainer.
Thank you. Sorry. It's really just at the middle school where
I'm trying to figure out how to finesse that, and I don't know.
Well, and but see, the one we brought last week didn't include Tennyson because of the same concerns you have, that they were to, they stayed.
That there was an opportunity that you'd have a full class of fifth grade students, and only one child in that class would actually feed to one middle school, and the rest would go to Tennyson.
And that was the downside to that.
Right, right, right. So but as far as the at the elementary level, it's right. Easy. The pain.
When did you graduate them? It's fifth grade.
Well, just like, you know, I guess pay special attention to Tennyson and Atlas. And I, my concern, I suppose, is creating some sort of impediment to growth in that program.
Oh, agreed, agreed.
That would.
But I've never thought any rezoning.
That would be a really bad result of this decision, if that were to, and I don't know how to keep my finger on the that pulse, but just I'll admonish the administration to pay attention to that in the coming years.
Rick, do you know offhand what elementary schools are zoned to feed Tennyson, setting aside Atlas?
We've got Parkdale, we have Mountain View, and Crestview.
And it's just those three?
I believe those are the three.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. Well, I will entertain a motion on the administration's recommendation.
Thank you, Mr. Hartley.
Thank you, Mr. Rick. Thank you, Rick.
So moved.
Thank you, Mr. Dupuy. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Cordawag. Any other questions, comments, discussion?
I just appreciate y'all being willing to go back and look at it and spend the time. You know, even though it's a small number of students, to those particular families, it's mm-hmm. a really big deal. And so it'd be easy to say, oh, this only affects 7 kids or 10 kids. And so I appreciate y'all taking the time to do what's best for
thank
them.
You. It really is. And we also keep in mind, we have one of the highest mobility rates. Yes, so it's always difficult. But thank you. I appreciate your compliment. I can't accept it. Mr. Hartley's actually the one that the compliment belongs to.
I think Ms. Tickell makes a great point. I mean, it would have been very easy to say this is just 6 kids a year who, you know, but instead letting them stay with their peer group they've gone to school with since kindergarten and finessing that a little bit and listening to that concern says a lot. All right, it's been moved and seconded. Any other questions or comments? All right, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? All right, motion carries unanimously. We've taken care of item C. Item 10D, gifts and grants to Waco ISD. Dr. King.
Yes, sir. Lowe's of Waco donated 19 staff volunteers to help set up a garden at Lake Air Montessori. The volunteers worked a total of 230 hours for an in-kind donation of $2,760. So that would be an increase in gifts of $7,388.79 in total cash items and services recorded for March 2016. The background information on the grants, which I will be recommending that the board accept. The Planting Poet Tree selected Tennyson Middle School as a Planting Poet Tree school. The grant award included a donation of poetry writing themed books and a visit and a reading from Dr. Carmen Tofaya, 2015 State Poet Laureate of Texas. Dr. Tofaya designed the grant as a means to provide students with a greater understanding of poetry and to spark excitement about writing. The value of this grant is $2,353.56. Brazos High School Credit Recovery received a grant from Region 12 Technology Foundation for $5,000. The district matched the grant with $5,000 to ensure complete funding for the $10,000 project. The project, Digital Library for Success, will allow teachers to create an online curricular library of video lessons and tailor assignments for students who are absent. Consequently, students can make up lessons via the online library and remain on track for graduation. Project HOPES, Healthy Outcomes Through Prevention and Early Support, is an initiative utilizing community-based organizations to prevent child abuse and neglect prevention services that target families and children from birth to 5 years. Funded by the Texas Department of Family and Protective Services and awarded to the Family Abuse Center, Waco ISD will be a subcontractor for this project. Waco ISD's portion of the grant, $193,655, will strengthen the district's early childhood education efforts through the addition of 2 full-time parent educators, along with curricular training, programmatic support, and supplies. So, and a little bit about that Project HOPES grant, there was some confusion about timelines in the community. It's really for a McLennan County project, and we were passed by, and Waco found Ashley Weaver took herself to Austin to talk to these people and say, look, this happened, that happened, would you let Waco ISD do it? And through her efforts, got this grant back for our community. And it just goes to show you that power of one. So I'm recommending that the board accept the gifts and grants as listed.
Thank you, Dr. Kane. I'll entertain a motion.
I move we accept the gifts and grants to Waco ISD as presented.
Thank you, Mr. Sykes. Is there a second? Thank you, Mr. Dupuy. Any other questions or comments? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Again, motion carries unanimously. Which now brings us to item E, consider application for a wine and beer retailer's permit at Taco Loco y Mas on Valley Mills Drive. Dr. Kane?
Well, as you noticed, there was not a recommendation because when I look back at your pattern, because this is actually kind of a board philosophy, but I couldn't find a pattern. So I brought the history and thought that the board might want to either make a pattern or discuss this or table it.
All right. If someone feels strongly about it, wants to make a motion to oppose the application, you can make a motion now.
Is it within the school limit of Crestview? Or is it,
it's Crestview. Yeah, Crestview. It's the one Crestview. It affects.
Yeah.
But well, when you think about where Crestview is and where this would be, you know, it's
quite a distance, yeah.
Yeah. Not like it's a course.
But it is within the distance where we had to get notice.
At least part of the property. I don't know if it's down even more than the playground area, parking area from Crestview, but it, yes, it is within 1,000 feet.
Mm-hmm. All right. Anyone want to make a motion? All right. Hearing none, that item dies for lack of a motion. And we will go on to announcements. Dr. King.
The only announcement I have is about baseball. University High will be playing Waco High tomorrow at 7 p.m. at Veterans Field. It is the final district game.
Thank you, Dr. King. Hopefully we'll see folks out at Veterans Field tomorrow night. Any other announcements from anyone on the board? All right. Then hearing no objection, we'll stand adjourned.